So as a final part of this session, I will actually demonstrate the steps that that some of you managed to do, just to ensure that that everybody knows what the process was. I know it's a little bit it's a lot of data and unpacking and putting together in the structure. So this is why I'll just show you. So what you have in your computers is a virtual machine, meaning a virtual computer with a virtual operating system, a full setup. And it's a Linux machine. It has one account called McStas that has a password of McStas. So that means I can log in. So that's a whole operating system, and as you see on the left you have normal MSDS and you have IFID and other things that we discussed and used, and in this virtual machine it's actually all set up together. So what I will do as a start is I will start my MSDS here, and then I will make myself a new instrument from a template. And not to do the manual editing of the file, I will actually take the predefined template semantic here that already has the indication of the source location, the sample location, and the detectors in place. So I get this one. This I now save in my phone data. Maybe I can make a note that that is now manned test or something like that. I go in there and then I save my file. Oops. Can I please save the file? Save it. Good. Okay, so that's the location of the file. What I will do first, I mean, it's a normal MSDS file, so you can of course use the edit server to open it. And if you ran that, you would get the normal MSDS type of output plus an event file, also in an ASCII format. So to enable the export of data to Mansit, what one needs to do is actually to touch the configuration of the user interface like this. And in here, we need to do a number of things. First of all, we need to instruct the C compiler that we want to enable Nexus. And what exactly to write here is system dependent. So on the Mac, it's slightly different than on the Windows, it's slightly different than here. So this is my Linux machine, and what I write is a define saying use Nexus, like this. And then also instruct to link with the Nexus libraries, like this. So what I also want to do is instead of running my normal MC display, I will run a special one at the bottom here, which is Perl based and has the possibility to output some Mansit XML. So this I put here, and in my run I will actually do my run format equals Nexus, and what this will do is it will ensure that the file is compiled with Nexus, and then it will instruct the simulation process to use the Nexus format. So once this is compiled in, your instrument actually speaks two languages. It speaks normal ASCII MSDS, and then it speaks Nexus. So then this I will save. And this means that I can press run. So the compilation is going on here. And then, in fact, the first step is to do a trace. And it says MC display WebGL here. That has to change to become Perl and format Mansit. And then I'll just use a single neutron, because no neutrons are actually embedded in this information. It's just the geometry of the instrument. So I press start, and I don't get any display or anything. No, I don't want to. So, McGooey now reports back that we're done generating the instrument definition file. And in fact, if we look back at the file manager maybe, so I'm looking at my Manset test. You see I have something here called template sense Manset insta.xml. And of course, we could use an editor to look at that. And that is simply the kind of formatting that that describes the geometry of an instrument in the Manset package. Yes. So now we're ready to do a simulation. So I will do run, and then I will do simulate, and then I will do a little more. I will do maybe send to the settings. And I'll just start. Actually, I might even, I will actually recompile for NBI, and I will use both of the cores in my machine. And it's, also the same thing, actually. Takes slightly longer. So now we actually see, so this is running in parallel. I'm running on two processors of the machine. So still 13 seconds or so. And if I go back then to my phone, here is an output dataset, which has an H5 file inside. And that should actually open with Manset. I can't remember if I also have an HDF view or other things that support Manset on here, but they of course also open this file. Right. Then, if I do, oops. If I then do Manset. So Manset plot here. Here I can load a file. I can pause for Manset test and the directory and the event file. So it will already suggest an output workspace name here that's MC Pro. I run that. And when I get back, so this one is trying to call back to the UK. It doesn't have access to. It's trying to call back to the UK because Manset actually provide updated instrument definitions for the instruments at ISIS and SSS. So that error message hasn't got anything to do with my thing here. So in the list of workspaces, we now have different things. If you remember from the small SANS exercise, you would easily get something like this. Probably I should play with some parameters for my scattering. I will do this at this point. So what is also available here is the event data. And one way to see that is actually to show a view of the instrument. Here you have the instrument geometry as Manset sees it, and one of the things we can do is that we can if I do side by side here and just get what is in my detector. And for instance, I could go and I could look at the individual pixels of the detector that will then have signals as a function of time of flight. And this means that in principle, one is able to run all the different algorithms that that Manset provides. And if I'm not mistaken, there should in fact be on our wiki as part of the instruction for McStas and Manset. Okay.
its personality. Next we got the software. That's it.
To have you install it locally, mm-hmm. That is because often the installation of Nexus and also getting mounted, downloaded and everything, I mean, I should have thought of that in that case. We should have prepared that earlier. In principle, on Windows, it's not too bad. On the Mac, it's completely terrible. It really doesn't work. So this is why. Alongside McStas 2.5, where you download this, there's a folder called Extras, and inside that, there is an Nexus package. And that should then work together with the instructions for the compiler listed on this page. So it should, in fact, work. But it's not a big mistake for that. And especially on the Mac. I was unsure who had what systems when it had this. I would think anyway, probably you will set up a common infrastructure of some kind, maybe you have already a small cluster or a common workstation for some of the simulations, and that would be a good place to have this. But in Linux, especially Ubuntu or Debian, it's completely straightforward.
Yeah.
You just apt-get install and image.
And this can also be used as another server.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Good. Yeah. So Maybe actually I give the there's a do's and don'ts presentation.
Yeah.
We just get this over with, and then we'll soon have record.
Okay.
Good.
So kill this one here. That. And then I've compiled a small set of I don't know how much do's and don'ts in it, but it's a few last words. Like this. Okay. So yeah. So just a few tips that were not perhaps outlined completely. Want to reiterate them, and especially also some words about documentation and contact with McStas team and so forth. So a reminder that it's often a key point that people don't get. McStas intensities are neutrons per second, and this is carried through the instrument on a discrete set of rays. A number of events that together carry the intensity, but do not one-to-one correspond to neutrons as such. They are rays. Efficiency. When doing simulations, of course, thinking carefully about what you are doing, you should apply focusing. So this means at the source, you should apply spatial focusing. There's no point in simulating what goes to the other side of the facility. On the chopper instruments, think about focusing technically. If you, for instance, a component model like the ESS source, it has the possibility of defining a time window, a distant time window. So it means, especially because we have a long pulse at ESS, perhaps quite a few of the neutrons that we get from this big pulse is actually thrown away by our first chopper. So one idea is to apply temporal focusing, meaning only emit neutrons from the source that actually have a chance to reach the first chopper. Also, of course, once you have investigated that you don't have a frame overlap from pulse to pulse, so before you start doing virtual experiments, you probably need to focus in wavelength also. There's no point in wasting lots of CPU on the things that will not interest you in the long run. Do focusing at the sample, so your detector is limited in space. Focus on that. You can also carefully, of course, apply the split in front of samples, but it really should be in front of samples, because otherwise you will simply repeat a deterministic calculation, and there's not much gain in that. Alternatively, you can actually also use MCPL, that's this binary particle list format. In principle, what you can do is you can do a simulation that defines your primary spectrometer, and then you end that right before the sample. And then you have some nice descriptive, let's say maybe standard modes of the instrument. And this means that you can use the same data many times for different samples. So in that sense, MCPL is actually quite, it corresponds quite to the same as a split. Because in fact, when you run this on an NBI, a parallel system, all of the nodes will actually read the same file. So in this way, it becomes a repetition implicitly. And that's actually also the only way that you control how much statistics is in your simulation based on MCPL. That is a number of repetitions of the file. Okay. So all of this is actually variance reduction or biasing. It is focusing on the color to your parameter region of interest. Good.
didn't touch so much upon this, but McStas is what we call embarrassingly parallel. It means that essentially the code in McStas is kind of a for loop. So you have a lot of initialization, then you have a for loop which is for neutron number one through n count. That for loop, right? And of course it's straightforward to parallelize that. So on 10 processes, what you do is just run 1/10. That's exactly what we do. And we do this using NPI. So the mother process gathers input from the command line. This is spawned to all of the compute nodes, all the slaves. They do their calculation and mother gathers back the data, creating the completely normal data set, like you saw from the one processor. It's completely transparent. And we've tested it up to thousands of nodes, and I mean, it's completely linear. It's basically linear. Actually, I'm not sure it's a factor of two any longer. If you on your platform can have access to the Intel C compiler, that is actually often a good investment. So it used to give a factor of two in speed. Over the same instrument, the same C code compiled with GCC. Yeah. That's of course because they know the processes very well, and they know all the optimizations and everything. GCC is an open source collaboration. I don't know. The Intel folks know exactly what they're doing. Then, one important point here is still, the moment you get an ETA from your McStas, which is days or weeks or months, I mean, it might be right. I'm not saying that it's always wrong, but I'm saying you should think, am I actually asking the right question? Because it is, to first approximation, this is not intended for high performance computing or big clusters. It is for your laptop. That's the purpose of it. It was intended and designed by that. That being said, once the instruments are complicated enough, time of flight, repetition rate multiplication, lots of beams that reach your sample, a complex sample, 4π coverage, you want to fill in time of flight on all of those pictures, then it can be very long and you will probably need to go to the big computer. But as a start, try if you can do it with your laptop. So to assist you, that's not very readable, is it? To assist you a little bit for running on the HPC, I mean, it's not meant to be completely turnkey or plug and play or anything, but just to assist you a little bit, the command that is typically echoed on the graphical user interface, mc run something, this is what runs your simulation. It's also what you would be using on the command line if you ran your simulations there. And then we added in a small utility called MaxUp. And it comes in two variants for OpenVPS or Tor and oriented clusters or for SLURM clusters. And all it does is that it takes your input running, so what you would be running on your laptop, it takes that as an input and then it writes a batch file. That you can, with a little bit of editing, submit to your cluster with MaxStas installed and get back your data from the view. Good. Yeah, then I don't know exactly why this came right here, but I mean, of course, there's some test experience also here at CSNS, and it might be that you have some old models of instruments. And perhaps you want to check that this MaxStas stuff is also that it actually provides the same simulation output. And one of the things that we do in a systematically different way, that's actually reflectivities. So as you saw in MaxStas, we typically characterize it by an R0, an alpha, a slope to the reflectivity, and then the width of an error function. So this set of parameters parameterizing the reflectivity. Most of the guides, however, also read a reflectivity file from disk. So here is a link to a small utility that allows you to convert the ones that are in Vitesse to a format that McStas reads. Because I know it is one of the systematic errors when you compare an instrument code from Vitesse to McStas. So this is better use. Another interesting thing, for those that are real experts in Vitesse and think that, I'm not sure I want to learn this completely, or I'm not sure, maybe I mostly want to do Vitesse still, but it would be lovely to have the McStas single crystal in there, something like that. Again, it's not completely plug and play, but there is a utility in your McStas installation called McStas to Vitesse. And what it will do is prepare a C code, which is compiled using GCC as normal, and a small TCL snippet. And this means that you can actually then put it in your Vitesse, and you can run this McStas component as if it was a normal Vitesse module. It works. Good. Another tip, we discussed this a bit already, but it's good to remember that. How on earth can I get my monitor NB to do properly, or I really don't understand how the time definition of the disk chopper is. A great resource for examples, that is the folder code examples. More than 100 examples of things. I didn't remember that the statistics was this crazy, but 370 examples of 170, that's it. So you dig in your examples folder, it's really valuable. All of these have an author name. This means that if you think the reflectometer, the CRISP reflectometer looks interesting for you, but you don't know exactly what is going on, or something gives you a result that you don't understand completely. The person to contact is Rob Dalglish from ISIS, because he wrote this, he contributed this to McStas. And that means he's also willing to answer questions on it. And the same, here's a Spinnaker example, that's Mr. Knudsen that just left the building. Good. We are GitHub centered. We didn't touch this much upon it. All of the code for McStas and McXtrace is in the organization McStas and McXtrace in the repository MC code. It's not completely polished, but in principle, there are instructions so you may build your own McStas. If you think McStas 2.5, there's some bugs and you want to fix that, you just go ahead and take the source code. If you know how to fix the bug, please do it. And then give us a pull request. So he sent us the patch via GitHub. We will be really, really happy about that. Also, this is where I prefer, if you find a proper bug, I prefer that you define an issue in here. That's the best. It's much better than an email. I tend to sometimes forget emails because I get so many. Here, I know these are problems with my stats. And it's transparent to everyone. You can go in there, you can do it in a second, and we'll see exactly what problems are currently relevant for the newest release. I put in a few ones while we were here. Some I found that I didn't really know of before. So please use that. Also on there, not so known, is this wiki. So this is, for instance, where you will go if you want to compile your McStas. You will go and look in developer literature, accessing the code tree and how to build it, etc. This is also where you have instructions for the McStas method interface or other things that are kind of special. Dedicated tutorials and things like that goes on GitHub in the wiki. So as I said, This is where the bugs are. That's an old, so probably these are closed at this point. But if you go on issues, it will give you an idea of what the current problems of McStas are. Another important, actually very important detail, that is the McStas users mailing list. It's quite well spam protected, so don't be afraid of that. Please enroll, and what you will have access to is also a valuable resource. So in fact, it's the user forum and the place to seek help since 1997. All of the mails are there. Everything is there. I guess you would probably, so our search is unfortunately, I mean we are Google country, I'm sorry. But I guess you can probably also in Bing, you can search for some specific topic in a specific site. That's probably a way to do that. And I would do that simply to mailman, I think it's called mailman 2 now, but you go and find the archives and you can search into that. So you have the very early messages about someone, oh, I tried downloading it and it looks kind of nice, from 1997 and all the way through to today. This is also where we, among other places, we indicate that there's a new version of this. This is where you stay in touch in the general sense. It's really, really very open and friendly. There is no such thing as a stupid question. There is not. Don't be shy. Please ask your question. It's perfectly okay. And if a question is really very specific, it might be that it's not even me who answered, or Eric or Mass. It might be a component author, or it might be another user that was in a similar situation and found a good solution. And it's completely international. We have Chinese that ask, we have Russians, we have Americans. It's a complete international forum. Yeah, mailing list, McStas users at McStas.org. I will keep this website up. You will just stay. That's my point. Just stays. What we didn't look so much at is that there's actually quite at the bottom of the page. Quite a long list of useful links. So all the things we just talked about. How do I log on the mailing list? How do I download McStas? Where's the GitHub? Bug reporting? E-neutrons? Anything you can imagine is in here. There's also material from other schools. It's only going here, I've realized that the Dropbox is not really available here. And this means that I'm actually planning to take some of the old material and move it to a common platform so you have a chance. And then final slide, I believe. If you prefer to talk to us directly, of course you can do that. We know each other. So here are the emails. For the tutors of the school, and that's all I had. And it was really nice being here, and I like working with all of you, and hope to see you again some other time, and that you will continue with success and doing a good job. Thank you.